So welcome everyone. Andreas Callas, today we present his work. Andreas Callas received his bachelor and master degree at the University of Cagliari. Since then he's a research fellow at the CNR and IMATI. His research field is computer graphics, and in particular he's interested in shape modeling, shape recognition, and knowledge organization. So today we'll talk about the framework for the semantic aware modeling of objects, and I leave the word to him.
Thank you very much, Claudio. So in the latest years, we have seen an evolution in what is meant by 3D visual content. At the beginning, there was geometry modeling, for which an object was its mere geometric representation. But at a certain point, such an approach has faced its limitation, because the object representation, the resolution of the object representation has increased enormously, putting in difficulty the state-of-the-art algorithms, especially those used in real-time contexts. And the input data types have become more heterogeneous, coming, for example, both from high-resolution scanners, smartphone picture sets, and so on. So, lately we have seen a huge increase in the efforts for trying to introduce an intelligence layer into the shape modeling. And these should consider other properties than just the object geometry, for example, its meaning, how it functions, what is its intended usage, and how it can fit into a more complex scenario. And the use of this approach will allow different improvements, going, for example, from the reduction in complexity in state-of-the-art algorithms to the possibility of deriving more natural interfaces for the users. There are a lot of works which tried to set up a semantic approach. For example, in this one, the authors try to exchange some interchangeable components for obtaining new shapes, as you can see, for example. And in this other two, instead, the shape of the object is modified following some textual attributes, like more compact, more comfortable, and so on. So in this scenario, the goal of my research is the definition of a framework in which a domain expert can formalize his knowledge about about a certain class of objects, all sharing some common properties, in such a way that anyone can perform shape modeling in a semantic aware way. The conceptual representation of the domain expert knowledge is what I call parametric template, and should be built on both geometry and semantics of a class. This is not always possible. For example, sometimes we don't know the geometry of the object in a class. You can consider, for example, the cases of large base shard collection in archaeology, in which we don't have a complete object. Or in other cases, we may not know anything about the class. For example, if the expert hasn't completed their study on the material. In these cases, we can consider geometrizing the semantic structure that is exploiting the knowledge for producing some kind of dummy shape. Or, on the other side, we can think of semantizing the shapes, that is, applying shape analysis tools for extracting information about the class. In any case, to better exploit the potentiality of the framework that I have in mind, I need both geometry and semantics to be defined. So the shape of the class depends on the number of objects available. I said that it can be a dummy shape if we don't have any complete object, or it can even be an archetype if we have only a handful of them, or at last it can be a statistical model. I will detail these concepts in the following. Once that we have obtained a representative shape for the class of object, we can exploit it in many ways. For example, by applying shape analysis techniques for segmenting it into meaningful parts, taking measures, and so on. Or we can deform it for obtaining new shape or to animate it. Now, talking about the semantics of the class, I said that it should be the formalization of the domain expert knowledge. But how can it be possible to formalize it? The natural language is prone to ambiguities, and furthermore, it is not machine ingestible, or at least not yet. So a better way for formalizing the knowledge is to exploit the concept of ontology. And this Conceptualization and knowledge is widely used, for example, in the semantic way, and they allow us to impose simply some structural relationship between parts. For example, the hand is connected to the forearm, and so on. Then the link between the semantics and the geometry is given by what is called 3D part-based annotation, and consists in the association between selections of part of an object and some information of any kind, for example, the text, multimedia. But I'm interested in the so-called tagging, that is associating some conceptual tags taken from the ontology to the selections of parts of an object. This association is extremely important for the template to be effective, and in fact, I need to ensure its persistence after any kind of transformation. Okay. Now, I will present my first results. Part of the semantic structure that must be stated by the domain expert depends on some measures that are taken from the geometry of the parametric template. For example, there can be a relationship between the head of the statuette and the base on their model. And these measures can be taken manually, but this would require a great effort from the user if the class counts, for example, thousands of objects. And furthermore, it is very difficult to define an unambiguous way for taking such measures. So I aim to provide the framework with a great amount of shape analysis tools. And my first work in this sense regarded the extraction of some simple descriptors from horizontal slices taken from statues that are part of an archaeological collection. It is called Aierini Collection. So I used these descriptors for segmenting the statuettes into meaningful parts and to classify them into handmade and will-made. The segmentation works by clustering the horizontal slices using the value of their descriptors, and you can see the results here, while the classifier performed surprisingly well considering the simplicity of the descriptors. If you're interested, maybe I can explain you later what descriptors are. So the other result come from the annotation persistence that I have mentioned. I said that I need to ensure the survival of the annotation after any kind of transformation. But under certain conditions, I can say that the majority of the transformations would not afflict the annotation in any way. For example, if you consider to map the annotation onto the geometry as lists of indices, for example, to vertices, there is no way for which an affine transformation applied to the vertices would afflict the annotation. This, however, cannot be said for the change of resolution or change of representation of objects, for example, passing from a point cloud to a voxel representation. So, in this work, I address the change of resolution issue, and here I define an annotation as a couple composed of a geometric selection, that is a mesh subset, and some information of any kind. I designed and implemented an algorithm for transferring an annotation from a source mesh onto a target mesh representing the same object. And it works by locating the geometric selection onto the target mesh and annotating it coherently with the source mesh. I don't enter the details because maybe I'm not from the field. So. But you can see the results here in the slide, where different transfer between different selection or with different topology can be seen, and this image shows the goodness of the transfer procedure. Now, what remains to do? I still have to set up the semantic structure to define how we can extract the representative shape for the class, how we can perform the constraint deformation, and the plus they need to validate the entire framework. For helping the domain expert, I plan to implement a user interface for annotating the regions of interest on the shape, following the example of this shape annotator, which is a tool that allows different kinds of selections and their association with conceptual tags taken from an ontology. Then I plan to extend this interface for allowing the user to state some relationships between attributes of the key concepts of the ontology. Notice that these attributes can define spatial properties such as the central position or other, and measures such as the volume of an interesting part, but even stylistic properties such as the color or the presence of patterns. The high-level representation of the resulting relationship structure will be a graph, or better, an hypergraph, that we will use for imposing constraints on the deformation, but possibly even for other ends. Now, talking about the extraction of the representative shape, it should be simple to build. We can think of electing the shape of one object in the class as an archetype, but since the shape of the objects in the class can vary considerably, this approach can introduce an excessive error. So we use this approach only when we have a handful of complete objects. Another possibility is to exploit the concept of a statistical model that is widely used, for example, in the medical field for having a canonical reference shape. And it works by taking sort of average of the shapes in the class and coupling it with a measure of the variance of those shapes. And this tool greatly satisfies our need for a representative shape, and it allows even a successive classification of the new and unseen objects, but at the cost that it requires a pretty big amount of complete object to work. So we will use these two concepts, and I will follow the state of the art for this part, choosing the most suited technique for our case. Conversely, the constraint deformation is a very difficult concept. I am interested in interactive speed for the deformation, and so I am focusing on the so-called handle-based deformation techniques, which provide some handling abstraction that once moved or deformed, propagate the deformation on the associated shape following a vertex linear interpolation scheme. There are two typical kinds of handling abstraction, these two, cages and skeletons, both having pros and cons. For example, the skeleton is better suited for imposing structural constraints, while the cages are better suited for the remaining. And so I am planning to implement a novel handling abstraction, which will be a sort of hybrid between them, and will be made of skeleton segments for deformating tubular parts like the arms, and of partial cages for manipulating the remaining, like the torso. This is probably the hardest and most innovative part. In fact, I need to set up a novel handling abstraction to deep study its behavior at the boundary of each segment. And I need to map the semantics onto the handling abstraction for imposing constraints to the deformation, which must be at interactive speed. But I think this will be feasible. In fact, I found some works that follow a similar approach even without constraints, and they achieve great results. So, at last for the validation, I am planning to validate the framework in two different scenarios. The first one is that of the archaeological reconstruction, in which the framework will be a sort of virtual workshop in which the archaeologist can perform a virtual reconstruction where the template will guide the posing of the fragments by suggesting compatible fragments and how they can be positioned and oriented in the space. Here, the template should adapt to the size of the fragments, and the annotations present both on the template and on the fragments should be transferred between them. And at last, the template should complete the missing parts of the object under user request. This scenario comes directly from a European project in which I was involved, that is called Gravitate, and which goal is the creation of a digital platform for the reunification, reassociation, and reassembly of heritage artifacts, basing on their 3D geometry, and so on applying shape analysis tools, on color features, and on the analysis of semantic metadata and the documentation in general using natural language processing techniques. The second scenario instead is that of the object design, in which the user wants to reuse some parts of an already modeled object, and so the framework should suggest an alternative for the structural parts of the object, but even it should allow the visualization of the new shape, in the contextual search, that is, for example, searching for all the object that, that contains a particular part, and the registration of parts onto the template, and at last the deformation of the object and of the shape of the object and even of its topology to meet the user requests, provided that they satisfy the requirements, the constraints that we impose on the template. And I think that's all for my presentation. It was pretty short. Thank you very much for your attention. If you're interested in the references, they are here, but you can come and I will show you close. So, questions?
Okay, I have a good question. When you show, I missed a thing when you show the four meshes and you say that there is no loss of information from, couldn't appreciate the difference.
Yeah, the color is not really good. So here you can see a contour, another
yes.
is one. So this is a selection with some holes in that.
Okay.
So this is for showing the generalization of the procedures which work with a selection of different topology. Here we have, I think, a resolution of 50,000 vertices, 100,000 vertices,
okay.
and 1 million vertices, and then again 50,000 vertices. So you can, it's difficult because it's not a zoomed in view,
okay.
but there is a very low error in transferring
okay.
the annotation between them. And here I put a zoomed in, which you can see the number of triangles, of vertices,
yes, okay.
and you see that there is no much error.
Okay.
Yeah, I was very fast.
Maybe I didn't understand well what is an annotation, but my question is, in the paper you cite, I was wondering if in that paper there was a whole set of annotation according to a whole set of shapes, or there were a general definition for annotation, let's say, for a given vertices in that paper, they tell you how put the annotation on that?
No, this is a general approach.
Okay.
In fact, I've implemented even a user interface, which was, I cited it. The idea is to make the domain expert or the archaeologist select a part in which he is interested and associating to it some information. So for example, if the domain expert is working on a statuette, he selects the nose, okay? He selects the nose at one resolution. But in the platform that we were planning to implement in this project, there are different types of techniques of algorithms that are applied to the shapes, and each one of them have different requirements on the resolution to work. But the archaeologist should not see the difference passing from one algorithm to the other. So it works on one resolution, and we needed to have different resolution of the same object with the same annotations. So the algorithm was used for preserving the annotation in the different resolution for the archaeologist. I don't know if I answered. Other questions?
Thank you again.